In this lecture, I'll explain everything you need to know about the t-test. This lecture is divided into two parts. There are many different kinds of t-tests, so first I'll provide a quick overview of the different types, how you can perform them in R, and how you can interpret their output. In the second part, I'll explain how t-tests actually work and show the calculation involved. All t-tests are used to demonstrate a difference between two means. They work by assuming that there is no difference, and this is called the null hypothesis, or H0. Then the t-test compares the actual means relative to their standard error, which is a measure of uncertainty. This t-value is then your evidence against the null hypothesis, and if the t-value is very large, then you have enough evidence to reject the null hypothesis and start believing that there is a real difference, which we call a significant difference. How large this t-value should be depends on the degrees of freedom and the chosen level of significance alpha. These will be discussed later on in the video. First, I'll provide a quick overview of the different kinds of t-tests and how you can perform them in R, starting with the one-sample t-test. The one-sample t-test is the simplest of all t-tests, which compares a single group mean to a theoretical value. So for example, if we measured the height of 6 males, and we want to know whether their height differs significantly from 1.8 meters, we could use a one-sample t-test. Of course, you could simply calculate the sample mean and already conclude that it's different. In this case, these males are on average about 1.85 meters, so that's different from our theoretical value. But remember, this is just a sample. This is just a random subset of the population of 6 males, and in reality, there are many more males than just these 6. So is this a coincidence, or are males actually larger than 1.85 meters on average? This is what we want to know. Could this sample have arisen from a population with mean 1.8 meters? So does this sample mean differ significantly from our theoretical value? If you enter the data in R, you can perform the test using the function t.test, and the output will look like I've shown here below. What you have to do is check whether the p-value is lower than the chosen level of significance alpha. So for example, with the commonly used value of alpha is 0.05, we would conclude that there is no significant difference, because in our case, the p-value is about 0.1739, which is larger than 0.05. In other words, our sample may as well have come from a population with mean height 1.8 meters. We have insufficient evidence to conclude otherwise. In the example I just gave, we compared the mean to 1.8 meters, and all this does is ask whether the mean differs significantly from 1.8 meters. That could mean that it is smaller or larger, so it's called a two-sided test. You can also perform a one-sided test, for example by asking whether men are significantly taller than 1.8 meters. In R, you can do this by specifying the alternative. Usually the alternative is two-sided, so if you specify nothing, R will perform a two-sided test. But if you, for example, specify alternative is equal to greater, then it will perform a one-sided test whether the mean of height is larger than the value of 1.8. And if you specify alternative is less, then it will ask the question, are men significantly shorter than 1.8 meters? Whether you test one-sided or two-sided will have a large effect on the p-value, so you have to choose carefully. Also, you have to choose this before conducting the experiment. If you choose to test one-sided after you know the result, this will increase the chance of a false positive beyond the level of significance alpha. Next, we'll discuss the two-sample t-test. In a two-sample t-test, we compare two sample means. So suppose that we measured the height of 6 males and 6 females, and we want to know whether they're different. Again, you can simply calculate their means and conclude that they are indeed different. So the first one, the males are 1.85 on average, and the females are 1.72 on average. But remember, these are just a small subset of the population. These are just 6 of the many available men and women. So what we really want to know is whether their group means differ significantly from each other. In R, this works almost the same. In this case, we need a vector of the male heights and a vector of the female heights, and then we use the t.test function again. This will again return a p-value, and if we use the same level as before of 0.05, then in this case we would reject the null hypothesis because the p-value of 0.089 something is much lower than 0.05. So in other words, there is a significant difference in the mean height of men and women. Again, you can also test in a single direction. The question we just asked is whether their means are different, which could be that the men are shorter than the women or that they are taller than the women. But if you have some a priori reason to assume that men are taller, you could specify that the alternative should be greater, so that men have a greater mean than women. Or you could ask the opposite question. Are men significantly shorter? And this is done by specifying alternative is equal to less. This will change the p-value, so choose carefully. And again, you have to choose this before you conduct the experiment. There are additional choices for a two-sample t-test, the first of which is whether you want to assume equal or unequal variance. What this means is, do you think that the groups vary to the same extent? If, for example, men range from about 160 to 2 meters, and women ranged all the way from 1 to 3 meters, then clearly they would have a different variance, and this is shown in the lower figure. If you assume that given the group mean, you assume more or less the same size of deviations in both directions, then you assume equal variance. So can the groups be expected to vary to the same extent around their mean? For height, this is clearly the case. This is another of the arguments of the t.test function. You can increase the power of your test by assuming equal variance, and you do this by specifying var.equal equals true. You can also sacrifice this extra power for a safer assumption when you're not sure, and this is called a Welch t-test, and this is the default. So if you specify var.equal equals false, that's really the same as not specifying anything at all, because it is the default option. If you have reason to assume that the variance should be equal from a biological point of view, then you should use equal variances for slightly more power. The next choice is whether you have independent or paired data. A regular t-test assumes that all observations are independent, but in the example I've given below, we have 6 measurements of the same individuals measured before and after they took a medicine for reducing blood pressure. These are 2 sets of measurements from the same individuals, so they are not independent, and this is what a paired t-test is for. If we enter these data into R, we have 2 vectors before, which is the systolic blood pressure before taking the medicine, and after, which is the systolic blood pressure of the same individuals in the same order after taking the medicine. The simplest one is then, is there a difference before and after using the medicine? And you do this simply by specifying paired equals true, and it will perform a two-sided paired t-test. You can also ask whether the blood pressure has fallen after medicine use. Perhaps these are hypertension patients and we want to know whether this drug is effective at reducing blood pressure. So in that case, we're only interested in a decrease and we specify alternative is greater, asking the question, are the before measurements on average larger than the after measurements? Perhaps there are already other medicine available for reducing blood pressure and we want to know whether this one is particularly good. So we are not interested in a significant difference, but we are only interested in a significant difference of at least 5 millimeters of mercury, for example. In this case, you can specify a different null hypothesis using the mu argument. So the last t-test I've shown here asks whether the blood pressure has fallen significantly more than 5 millimeters of mercury. Lastly, we have the non-parametric alternatives. So why would you use these? A t-test assumes that values within groups are normally distributed. That means that most values are close to the mean, some are further away, and the rare few are far away. It also means that the deviations are symmetric. Deviations in either direction are assumed to be equally likely. So let's take height as an example, using a mean of 1.8 meters and a standard deviation of 0.07. In this case, male height is expected to be between 1.73 and 1.87 meters, which should contain about 68% of all men. Some are up to 2 standard deviations away, and only a few are less than 1.66 or more than 1.94, which is around 5% of all observations. And the further you go away, the smaller the chance of observing something like that. This assumption is not always reasonable. If we take adult male height in the Netherlands, then approximate normality will probably hold. Most men are indeed 1.8 meters, and most men are close to that value, and fewer are farther away, and deviations in either direction are equally likely, and it is a continuous distribution. But let's say that we have a completely different example, like the number of birds in the park. First, you cannot count 1.5 birds, so this is not a continuous distribution, but a discrete one. Second, you cannot count -1 bird, so the distribution stops at the value of 0. You can count 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and any other larger number of birds, but you cannot count a negative number of birds, which means that if the mean is close to 0, as is shown here, the distribution will have a strong right skew, which means that it is no longer symmetric. The same problem arises when we have the correct number of answers out of 20 questions, which follows a binomial distribution. In this case, you can have, at the very least, 0 questions right, and at the very most, 20 questions right. So this distribution is bounded in two directions. Also, it is again a discrete distribution. And lastly, if the mean is close to 20 or close to 0, then this distribution will definitely not be symmetric. In the last example, we have the number of years until a light bulb burns out after continuous use. Now, most lights are not on all of the time, and if they're not LEDs, then they won't run for very long. So after 1 year of continuous use, most light bulbs may have already burned out. Also, a light bulb can burn out the moment after we start measuring. And after 2 years, there will be even fewer left, after 3 years, even fewer, etc. What I've shown here is an exponential distribution, and you can clearly see that although it is continuous, it is not symmetric. In all three of these examples, you cannot reasonably assume a normal distribution. For that, we have the non-parametric alternatives. In this case, the Wilcoxon test. If for whatever reason you cannot assume approximate normality, then you can use this test. And it works the same way the t.test function works in R, except you have to specify Wilcox.test, and then use the same arguments that we used before. So the first example shows an independent t-test, a two-sample t-test, and two-sided testing, and the second one shows one-sided testing. The third example is a one-sample t-test, and the last example performs a different kind of Wilcoxon test for paired data. How the Wilcoxon test actually works is explained in the second part of the video. Finally, I'll give a quick summary of all the different t-tests I discussed so far, and then I'll show how you can interpret their output. First, we had all the different options. So if you choose the default t.test and two different samples, this will perform a two-sample, two-sided t-test for unequal variance. If you want to test one-sided, you have to specify an alternative. If you want to assume equal variance, you have to specify var.equal is true. If you want to perform a one-sample t-test, then you have to specify the value under the null hypothesis. If you don't, then R will assume that the value under the null hypothesis is supposed to be 0. If you want to perform a paired t-test, you have to specify the paired argument. And if you want a non-parametric alternative, you can use all of the above using Wilcox.test. Note, however, that since the Wilcoxon test makes no assumptions about the distribution, it also makes no assumptions about the variance, so there is no var.equal argument. Next, we can interpret the output completely. In this example, I've shown a two-sample, two-sided t-test for equal variance, but in principle, the interpretation is the same for other t-tests. First, we see the t-value, which is our evidence against the null hypothesis that both means are equal. If this value is large, we have strong evidence. And if this value is small, we have weak evidence. But the exact value doesn't really mean anything until we have converted it to a p-value using the degrees of freedom. Now, I'll explain these degrees of freedom in a bit more depth in the second half of the video, but in principle, we had 6 men and 6 women, so that's 12 observations, and we estimated 2 means, namely that of the men and that of the women, so we have 10 degrees of freedom left. Using these two values, we can compute a p-value. And how you do that is also shown in the second half of the video. You can then compare this p-value to your level of significance alpha, and if the p-value is smaller, you conclude a significant difference. In the next line, it shows the alternative hypothesis, which is the hypothesis that we believe in once we stop believing in the null hypothesis. Then we see a 95% confidence interval, which is a measure of precision, or lack thereof, of our estimated difference. So this 95% confidence interval says that the mean should be between 0.04 and 0.23. Then we see the estimated sample means for both of our samples. So the first sample has an estimated mean of around 1.85, which is that of men, and the second one of 1.72, which is that of women. I'll show one more example, but again, the interpretation is more or less the same for other t-tests, but here is a big difference. If you perform a one-sided testing, then you are only interested in the difference in one direction. So that means that the 95% confidence interval only estimates one of the two sides as well. So you'll see infinity on one of the two sides, and this might be confusing. But it doesn't have to be, because all this really says is that the difference is estimated to be at least 0.06, and it can be from there to any larger value, because we didn't estimate the other direction. That concludes the first part of this video. In the second part, I'll explain how t-tests actually work and show the calculation involved.